So, I mean, you all know at this stage that the name Buddha wasn't this person's given name. It was a nickname that he gave himself. He was born Gautama Siddhartha, and he called himself Buddha, which literally means, I am awake. And many of the parables of Jesus Christ lead to the same conclusion. Very often he'll say stuff like, if the householder knew at what stage the thief was going to break in and steal, he would stay awake. And presumably, if you're a householder and you're concerned about a break-in, you're not going to be sitting in the dark waiting for the guy to kind of surprise you. You're going to have lights on so that you see the intruder as soon as they arrive in. So the idea of being awake and shining light is ancient. In fact, the word for progress is enlightenment. So the whole notion of shining light is very, very important. Now, for all of today, including this lecture here, what I'm attempting to do is I'm attempting to try to help us to wake up, because there are intruders in the house. And it means that we have to have our lights lit. Now, the difficulty is, I said to you this morning that I believe that America is a very, very bright light, and it's a real privilege to me that at age 40, you know, somehow I wound up in the States and at some stage became an American citizen. I'm very proud to be an American citizen because I think we have extraordinary potential. But bright lights cast very, very dark shadows. And we're casting really dark shadows as a nation on the world right now. Now, the thing is, it's not the light actually that creates shadows. When you think about it, the lights do not create shadows. What lights do is they force the kind of all present darkness to coagulate into more condensed versions of themselves. When you put a light on in a really, really, really all over dark space, what it does is it forces the darkness to coagulate into sections. And those sections are always hiding behind obstacles. So all shadows are when light encounters an obstacle. Now, unless you put the light on, there's a pervasive darkness, but there's no discrete part of it. Only when you shine the light do you actually see shadows. And the shadows, I would say, they're the coagulated, discrete packages of darkness. So if light is a quanta, this is the great insight of Einstein and people like Max Planck, that light comes in quanta. Quantum theory means quanta. It comes in little packages. Light comes in little packages that we call photons. So I'm going to make up a word right now, and I'm going to claim that darkness exists in little packages that I'm going to call darktons. And when you put the light on, these entities coagulate and they gather together for protection, and they create really, really dense packages of darkness. But it's not the light that's creating them. It's the light that's forcing the omnipresent dispersed darkness to coagulate, because there's kind of safety in numbers. And the object of the exercise is to identify what are the obstacles that are actually creating the darkness, because the obstacles are creating a refuge for the darkness to hide behind. If there were no obstacles, the entire darkness would disappear and there would only be light. And that's really been my objective for today and for this lecture as well. So I'm trying to help us to focus the great light that America is and could be, you know, into the pervasive darkness of our times, and therefore identify what are the obstacles that are allowing the darkness to seek refuge in these shadow materials. So if it feels like it's real dark, you know, I'm doing it intentionally as the first stage. Tomorrow I'm going to focus totally on the light and show us how do we intensify the light? How do we become more enlightened beings? But to do that, we have to identify what are the obstacles that are creating the shadows when the darkness coagulates and seeks refuge in togetherness. And that's what I've been attempting to do all of today, and what I'm going to attempt to do for this lecture here. And I'm doing that with a purpose, not to kind of depress us or make us feel anxious about our country or about our world or about our future, but to help us identify what are the obstacles that are allowing the pervasive darkness to find refuge in quantized, you know, discrete packages of shadow material, so that we can remove the obstacles and therefore create enlightenment for our time. So that's my entire objective. And so if it feels like it's a real dark journey, it only is because we're identifying how the darkness manages to get away with it. So lecture four, then I'm going to talk, I call it Dismantling the Matrix and Overcoming the Programming. So I'm going to start off then with the notion of fundamentalism in its many colors. Between 1878 and 1897, there was a series of conferences which were called the Niagara Bible Conference, went on over this period of several years, and was orchestrated by a group of Presbyterian theologians based in Princeton University. And they were concerned very, very much about the fact that there were two assaults on the Bible, and two assaults on Christianity, Protestant Christianity particularly. And one was an inside threat coming from liberalism and biblical criticism, particularly from the Germans. Great German Bible scholars had identified form criticism and biblical criticism, where they pointed out obvious discrepancies in the Bible stories that made it very, very obvious that they were not the monolithic, you know, writings of a character called Moses, and that they frequently contradicted each other, and that they came from different periods of biblical history. And this was very upsetting to a kind of mainstream Protestantism. And so they wanted to deal with this inside threat of liberalism and biblical criticism. And they wanted to deal with the outside threat of an atheistic science. So they're meeting to try to retrench and find if there is some common ground that all of the different Protestant denominations can come upon so that they can present a united front to the inside attack and to the outside attack. And they hit upon five fundamentals that they believed that all Christians could get behind. And that's the origin of the word fundamentalism, as far as religion is concerned. They identified five fundamentals, and they said, if we can all get behind these five tenets, we can present a united front to the inside threat and to the outside threat. And the five tenets they came up with were these. The literal inerrancy of the Bible, that the Bible is the infallible word of God. Can we all get behind that and say yes? Say yes, we can. The virgin birth of Jesus Christ was number two. That there is salvation only in Jesus Christ was number three. That Jesus Christ did really physically rise from the dead was number four. And number five, that he really did work miracles. So these were the five fundamentals that gave rise to the notion of fundamentalist Christianity. So the Bible is the infallible, inerrant word of God. Jesus was born of a virgin. You only get salvation in believing in Jesus Christ. He really did rise physically from the dead, and his miracles were authentic and real. Now, this was the united front that they then presented, and it came to a climax in the famous Scopes monkey trial in the 1920s, when there's a pitch battle between biblical Christianity and scientific materialism. So that's kind of the origin of the word. Now, there are four main steps to any fundamentalism. And fundamentalism is not peculiar just to religion. I'll show you other areas where we come across fundamentalism. The essence of fundamentalism is four steps. The first one is you take a very complex human situation, like God, belief in God, or whatever, and you reduce it to a few simplistic tenets that even the dumbest of us can understand. That's the first step. The second step is you identify an enemy. The third step is you dehumanize the enemy. And the fourth step is you make war on this dehumanized entity. And that's the essence of all fundamentalism, wherever you find it, whether you find it in the Bible, or you find it in politics, or you find it in economics. Reduce a very complex situation, and most life situations are very complex. Pretend it's a very simplistic. You have said the bottom line is, or everybody knows that, you know, or unless you accept that, we try to reduce it down. We identify an enemy, we dehumanize the enemy, and then we make war on the enemy. Now, in religion, the Protestant version of it was just what I told you a few minutes ago, the five tenets. There's a Catholic version of fundamentalism, and it goes like this. We have a man in Rome who's infallible, who, when he sits on the throne of Peter, speaking ex cathedra on matters of faith and morals to be held by all the faithful, is absolutely infallible. He will never make a mistake. It's the first part of fundamentalism if you're a Catholic. The second one is that when Jesus allegedly said to Peter in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 16, "Tu es Petrus et super hanc petram edificare ecclesia meam." You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And whatever you decree on earth, I'll decree in heaven. And whatever you say no to on earth, I'll say no to in heaven. That's the second tenet. That God is basically a rubber stamp for the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church can make up any kind of mishigas it wants, and God has to go along with the program. The second tenet. The third one was extra ecclesiam nulla est salus. Outside the Catholic Church, there is no redemption. This was the Catholic version of the Protestant saying there's only salvation in Jesus. Catholics are going to make it even worse. It's not just Jesus, the Catholic version of Jesus. If you don't accept the Catholic version of Jesus, then there is no salvation. And finally, that the Catholic Church literally has the power to send somebody to heaven or to hell for all eternity. Not only do we control your secular destiny and your incarnational experience, we determine where you're going to spend all of eternity. We're going to give you a thumbs up or a thumbs down on the basis of laws that we're going to make up. So that's the Catholic version of fundamentalism. And you and I, most of us here, we grew up accepting all of those, you know, and believing them to be true. Yeah, unbelievable. Unbelievable. Other religions had their own versions of it. Judaism had this crazy notion of that the Jews were God's chosen people. I sometimes make a joke, and I hope it's not in bad taste, that allegedly there was a covenant made between God and Abraham whereby God was going to trade real estate for foreskins. You circumcise your men, I'll give you a promised land. I mean, talk about a ridiculous belief system. Yeah, what a trade-off, foreskins for real estate. And people believed it. We're the chosen people. All we got to do is circumcise our menfolk, you know, and we get the promised land. And we're God's chosen people. It's amazing what people believe. If you're Muslim, the fundamentalist version is Sharia law, a law that allegedly allows you to cut off people's hands or tongues or noses for various kinds of crimes. That's their version of it. There's an atheistic version of it. Militant atheism is a belief system which cannot be proved. There is no way of proving that God does not exist. Now, you can't prove that God does exist either, although the preponderance of the evidence would suggest that there is obviously some kind of a creative entity and some kind of a superior intelligence. But you can't actually prove it. You can experience it, you'd be totally convinced of it, but you can't prove it to somebody who chooses not to believe in it. And by the same token, there is no way of proving that God does not exist. And in fact, it is much more difficult to prove God does not exist than to attempt to prove that God does exist. So militant atheism is another form of fundamentalism. And our world is wrestling with these two versions right now. Militant atheism versus militant, you know, monotheistic religions. But you find this same kind of fundamentalism in many, many different disciplines and arenas. And I'm just going to reel off a few statements and give them titles. If you can't see it, it doesn't exist. This is called scientism. It's not science, it's scientism. A belief system that if our senses can't pick up on something either directly or through our instrumentation, then it doesn't exist. That's scientism. That's a fundamentalist version of science. Trickle-down economics. Give the money to the people who already have it, you know, and the people at the bottom will eventually benefit. That's called corporatism. Trickle-down economics. Militarism goes like this. If you want peace, prepare for war. This is one of the dumbest statements ever made, but it sounds really, really, really wise. If you want peace, prepare for war. You prepare for war, you get war. You prepare for peace, there's a possibility you'll actually get peace. But you're certainly not going to get peace by preparing for war. So this is fundamentalist militarism. Nationalism goes like this. We're the good guys. And when we do shit, it's because the other guys deserved it. When they do it, it's because they're bad guys. When we do it, we've done it for good reasons. So that's kind of nationalism. Educationalism is children should be seen and not heard. I call this one Monsantoism. It's actually a statement made by an executive in Monsanto several years ago. Weeds are stealing our sunlight. Weeds are stealing our sunlight. So we have the right to develop stuff like Roundup and kill the bastards. So weeds are stealing our sunlight. I call that Monsantoism. And finally, I'm going to call it Big Pharmaism. All illness is by a chemical. Take a pill. Now, I'm not saying that some pills don't have use. They do. But that all illness is by a chemical, and the answer to all of it is just take a pill. That's, I call that Big Pharmaism. So we find fundamentalism all over the place. It's not just confined to religion. And the object is, you reduce a very complex situation to a few simplistic one-liners, identify the enemy, dehumanize the enemy, and attack the enemy. That's the first point I want to make. I'm going to just interject here that what I would like to do with this section is to speak until about 5 o'clock, and then for us to take a 15-minute break and come back, and then I want all of us to share our experiences, either based on the material of the last 4 lectures or life experiences. So I want the from 5:15 onwards to be us, you know, sharing our wisdom, you know, with each other. The second section I called the centralization of power. For hundreds of years, the thorn in the side of the Roman Empire were the Celts of Europe, particularly the Germans and the French Celts. They were the thorn in the side of the Roman Empire. And in battle, and in after battle, the Celts beat the crap out of the Roman legions. Battle after battle. But the Romans always won the wars. So the Celts, I would say probably, if you were to count the number of discrete individual battles, the Celts probably won the majority of their battles with the Romans. But they always lost the war. Because every chieftain, every Celtic chieftain was a law unto himself. They would take orders from nobody. Romans were totally centralized. And so no matter how many battles they lost, they eventually won all of the wars. So centralization confers extraordinary power, you know, on those who exercise it. When the British colonized East Africa, the one group of tribes they found impossible to suppress were the Kalenjin peoples. Because, and these are the people I lived among for 14 years. In every other tribe in Africa that the British encountered, or any colonialist regime encountered, they would go to the chief, and they would either bribe the chief or threaten the chief, and once they had the chief, they had the whole tribe in their pocket. The Kalenjin have no chiefs. There are no chiefs among the Kalenjin. If there is to be a war party, we're going to raid, you know, some other tribe's cattle, some guy will be elected, you know, the leader for the expedition. And as soon as we come back with, you know, 500 head of cattle, he reverts to lay status. If there is some kind of a religious ceremony to be engaged in, the Kalenjin had no priests. Some old man would be delegated, as the phrase that was used was boyotaptum, the elder of the ceremony. And the elder of the ceremony was elected for the ceremony, and he was the priest for the ceremony, and then he reverted to lay status as soon as the ceremony was finished. So the British encountered the Kalenjin, and they didn't know what to do with them. There was nobody to bribe, and there was nobody to threaten. And so they conquered all the other peoples of East Africa. They could not conquer the Kalenjin. In fact, the Kalenjin people are famous for these long, long earlobes. They pierce the ears and hang weights. And when the British put what they call the Lunatic Express across Kenya, beginning in Mombasa, going all across, down through the Rift Valley and across to Kisumu, the Kalenjin attacked it, tore up the lines, and beat them into earrings, and used the railroad as earrings. You'd hang these things hanging off their ears. Yeah. So the British didn't know what to make with the Kalenjin. They never actually conquered them. So if there isn't centralized power, it is very difficult to conquer a people, if everybody is a law unto themselves. Now, the opposite happens then when the really successful organizations that conquer are organizations that have created this extraordinary centralization of process. And you find that all over. You certainly find it in religion, where there's this pyramid of power in the Catholic version of it. You've got an infallible pope at the top. You've got a curia underneath that. You've got the other cardinals. You've got the archbishops. You've got the bishops. You've got the clergy, the priests. You've got the nuns. You've got the lay people. And at the bottom of the heap, you've got lay women. And that's the pyramid of power in the Catholic Church. So it's all centralized. It's a one-way communication system. Nobody can talk from the bottom up. Everybody gets dictated from the group above them down. So seminaries were training grounds for that process. So seminaries are extraordinarily centralized organizations with a rector in charge and a spiritual director in charge of the novices or whatever, and it's a very structured pyramid of power. The military, the very same thing. Many of these organizations, you know them. You know the centralization of power when you see that people have to wear a uniform, cut their hair in a particular kind of fashion, eat particular kinds of food, associate with particular kinds of people, and don't associate with other kinds of people. Do particular kind of drills and say, yes, sir, all the way up the line. You know you're dealing with centralization of power there. So you get that in the military, you get it in the seminary, you get it in the churches. Wherever you see people with the same haircuts, the same clothes, eating the same foods, you know you're in the presence of some kind of centralized power structure here. Politics, you get the very same thing. The whole structure of politics is ground up from, you know, the village chieftain, you know, in some other part of Africa, to the representatives for San Mateo County, for the senators for California, for the Congress, for the president, and then from the tiers that are way above the president, the corporations, the national banks, the corporatocracy, and then the bank of international settlements at the top of that, presided over by some kind of an unseen hierarchy that almost nobody knows and can't identify. We have some ideas who they are, but it's very difficult to identify them. The media is another way. So media has been centralized into fewer and fewer hands at this stage, and certainly corporations, it's true of corporations. The latest estimates are that 58 human beings own over 60% of the world's resources right now. 58 individual people own over 60% of the world's resources right now. And whenever you get centralization of power, you get abuse. 58 individual people own 60% of the world's resources. Yeah. And whenever you get that kind of centralization, you're going to get abuse of human rights and you're going to get control of the masses. So that's the second point, centralization of power. I'm trying to identify the obstacles so that we can remove them and become light. But we have to know what they are before we can remove them. The third topic I want to cover is the meme makers. Meme is a kind of a neologism, a word that was made up just fairly recently. And the best way to explain it is that a meme is to a culture what a gene is to an organism. An organism is composed of genes configured in particular kinds of ways. And a civilization or a culture is made up of particular kinds of ideas. I talked this morning about myths. That when you get a group of people believing in something, you know, it becomes their experienced reality. So although it's totally made up, it's a totally imaginary thing, like human rights is totally made up. There's no evidence for it, you know, in the biology outside of human beings. But once you accept it as a myth, it becomes a meme of the culture. In this instance, a very good meme. Capitalism is a meme. Communism is a meme. The United States of America, in some senses, is an imaginary order, to which now 318 million people subscribe, you know, and so it's a very powerful entity. So memes actually become the building blocks of cultures and civilizations. Now, sometimes they're really, really good, and sometimes they really, really suck. So who are the great meme makers on the international arena? Originally, they were the great...
Can we take a moment, please, to revisit? Meme is to something...
So meme is to culture as a gene is to an organism. So memes are the building blocks of culture, like genes are the building blocks of organisms. And so who are the great meme makers whose meme making is so powerful that it actually gets international acceptance? I would say the three great monotheistic religions have been the great meme makers that have had, you know, international impact. The really great empires have been international meme makers whose influence has been felt way beyond, you know, the geographic location in which they're situated. And the biggest group of all, I'm going to coin a term here, I'm going to call it the migratory oligarchy. This group of leaders from generation to generation over thousands of years who've migrated from one part of the world to other parts of the world using different empires, creating military superpowers in order to act as enforcers for their agenda. And as I said this morning, I think this has migrated towards the West constantly and will continue to move around our globe. Now, in my opinion, and I now realize I'm being really far out here, I believe that everybody in this room is here because we're part of some kind of a soul pod. We've been together many, many times in many, many different incarnations, different parts of the world, different genders, different times in human history. And we keep coming back as a group because we're dedicated to helping each other to grow in light. There's a group of souls, you know, who reside completely, on my words, obviously, at the A Street level of the spectrum of service to self versus selfless to other. They're technologically very, very advanced and very, very powerful, but they reside almost totally at the service to self level. And they've migrated from civilization to civilization throughout human history. to control the world population. And they are beings in whom compassion has atrophied on the vine. They have no compassion. The fact that decisions that they make are going to result in the deaths, literally, of millions of people in horrible wars or in starvation on a mass scale doesn't get between them and their cereal in the morning. So literally, compassion has atrophied on the vine of this group of people. And they come back, I call them then the migrating oligarchy, who've moved from civilization to civilization to civilization in order to create this agenda of world dominion. And they're very powerful right now, and that's what we're pitted against. And at the present time, it seems to me, they're using the American military-industrial complex to be the enforcer of this agenda. And our job is to try to identify that, because that's what we're up against. A meme can then be a cancer or can be an extraordinary growth-promoting idea. Jesus Christ's teaching was a very powerful meme. The teaching of the Buddha was a very powerful meme. The lifestyle of Mother Teresa was a very powerful meme. People like Rudolf Steiner and their teaching were really powerful memes. The likes of Mahatma Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. are really powerful memes. They have leavened our civilizations and they're still working there. The question is, can we identify, you know, and diagnose what are the memes that are creating light and what are the memes that are creating darkness? And so to paraphrase Socrates, I'm going to say that the unexamined meme is not worth living. The unexamined meme is not worth living. The unexamined meme is the first step in the slide into despotism and xenophobia and warfare and genocide. So to the extent that we're imbibing and drinking in that kind of propaganda so subconsciously that we're not even aware of it, often it comes in the form of even entertainment. But we're drinking in this bilge on a regular basis, and it is poisoning our civilizations and our psyches. Whenever you see anxiety or anger or fear or xenophobia, you can be sure that this is the result of forced-fed memes that have been pre-processed, pre-digested pablum, calculated to put us to sleep until they need us to wake up and be really upset about something. The only time they want us awake is when there's something they need us to do, like riot in the streets, you know, or kill little babies. I got an email this morning from a good friend of mine who lives in Palo Alto, Laura Palmer. She's, some of you may know her. She's a clinical psychologist, mother of twin boys who are 12 years of age and a little boy who's 10 years of age, an extraordinarily dedicated woman who 2 or 3 years ago went to Rwanda in the wake of the genocide committed in Rwanda to try to upgrade, you know, to trauma therapy for people visiting clinics. And she told me this story a few days ago. I had a conversation with her and I asked her to email me the blog where she had written about it, and I got her email this morning. In Rwanda, several years ago, there was a genocide created between two tribes, the Hutu and the Tutsi, in which over 2 million people died. And they attacked each other with machetes. They didn't have machine guns or kind of military hardware. They attacked each other with machetes. And Laura is in this clinic outside of Kigali 2 years ago. And there's this young mother sitting in the clinic nursing two little twins, just 7 or 8 months old, and a six-year-old boy. And Laura gets talking to her through an interpreter. 5 of this woman's children had been slaughtered. In front of her eyes by her neighbor with a machete. Her neighbor, because she was the wrong tribe in the wrong village. And this woman is sitting in a clinic with 2 sick babies, and she's been there for 3 days, and she can't get a service because she lacks $6. And the policy of the clinic is, we can't afford to treat people for free. The clinic will go under, so we have to charge something. So we're making a minimum fee, and this woman couldn't meet the minimum fee. And it was against the policy for anybody to pay it on her behalf, because that's, you know, self-sufficiency is part of the clinic's operation. So Laura is sitting there watching this young woman. So she got a solution. She said to the manager, if I look after those 2 little boys, 2 little babies for the day, and you allow this woman to wash the floors of the clinic, will you give her $6 to pay the fee so the kids can be treated? And I said, yes, we can do that. So for the rest of the day, Laura is looking after two little infants, twins. She has twins at her home back in Menlo Park. And she's looking after these little twin boys so the mother can scrub the floors to get $6 to have her children treated so she can walk back 2 days' journey to the village where five of her kids were slaughtered. Yeah. Now that's the power of a meme. That is the power of a totally made-up story to send two tribes of people at each other's throats and wipe out 2 million children. That's the power of meme. Part of the reason we're here, guys, is that we desperately need to become meme makers. We need to create a different myth which is so attractive that it can overpower the darkness. That's the reason we're here today in this room. It's the reason we're part of communities like COJ. It's the part of the reason that there are tens of thousands of little groups like us all over the world also trying to create a myth which is so powerful that will overcome the myth of darkness. So we have to eschew myths that divide us. And they're all over the place. One version of it is class warfare. So there's a lower class, there's a middle class, there's an upper class, there's an elite group, there are the aristocrats, the royalty, and then finally the oligarchy, whoever they are and whatever they hang out. There's the separation of denominational affiliation, divide us up by religion and have us attack each other and savage each other. There's divide us up into Democrat and Republican in our country, break us apart and then have us at each other's throats, get us excited about stuff, even though there are real issues that need to be debated. Get us excited, and I say this with all honesty here, even delegitimize the presidency of the United States. I have lots of issues with Donald Trump and his policies, but the fact that you're going to delegitimize a presidency and try to overthrow somebody who went through the process of getting elected by the American population who chose to vote, you know, in order to force a war with Russia that he seems to be getting in the way of by wanting to reach out to Putin. There's something really sick about that. Now, I didn't vote for the guy, and I have real issues with many of his policies. But to tear down the very office of President of the United States of America in order to score points against somebody who's unintentionally, because the guy's a total narcissist, you know, I don't know why he's doing it, but he is doing it. He's an obstacle at the moment to the agenda of making war with Russia, and he has to be removed. And so much of the chaos and the vitriol that we're hearing on the liberal and the Republican ends of it are to create a sufficient anger that we get rid of this guy and we appoint somebody who'll get out of the way and let this war proceed. Having said that, I'm not in favor of most of his policies, but I have to stand for the office of the presidency of the United States of America. I want to talk about fake news. Fake news is a very modern term, but it's a very old reality. And the people who are crying the loudest at the moment about the fake news merchants are the fake news merchants themselves. The people who have been creating fake news since the oligarchy began in prehistory. The people who have always created the fake news and continue to create the fake news are the people who are shouting fake news at the alternative media who are trying to represent, you know, some of the reality to us. And they're being demonized and censored in various ways. This is an old, old, old system. The prophet Jeremiah talked about it way, way back, 600 BC, where he talked about the real prophets and the false prophets. The notion of court historians, historians who write the history to please the king, you know, for whom it's being written. History, as I pointed out this morning, is always written by the winners. And news is always written by the current crop of leaders, where history is written by the old leaders. News is written by the current crop of leaders, and propaganda is written by the wannabe leaders. And they're the propagators of the fake news. And we're the consumers of the fake news. And we're at each other's throats. You can't, you know, turn on a TV broadcast without finding, you know, two people on opposite sides screaming abuse at each other. neither of them listening to the other person's perspective. There has to be value in both sides. Intelligent people on both sides of the equation are trying to protect something that they value. If we don't listen to each other and create a synthesis, trying to protect what's of value on both sides and create a synthesis of these belief systems, there is no way forward for our world or for our country. But the mass media are not giving us that kind of discussion. They're giving us, you know, dogfights between savage people who are just goring each other as much as they can. And then anybody who's trying to stand up and say, wait a minute, guys, these are not the real issues. Here's what we should be talking about. They're not going to get a hearing. They're going to be censored. They're going to be shut down. And they're going to be called the purveyors of the fake news. One of the appeals I made to you, and I know it's really difficult, and probably none of you managed to do it, was to do a Lenten fast on news. Because the truth is, what you're getting in your TV and your radios, it's not news. It's the old propaganda repackaged for modern situation. And so continuing, you know, to kind of listen to this, you know, it's like you're letting bilge into your sitting room. So the very same people that are shouting fake news, fake news, fake news, are the people who told us there were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, and we went in and we killed 2 million people on the basis of that fake news. The very, very people who told us that there was biological weapons being used in Syria by the president against his own people are the people who gave us 400,000 dead Syrians and millions of Syrian refugees. And fake news. They're the people who are pointing and saying, no, fake news is the other side. Fake news is the other side. The very people who told us that the Patriot Act was patriotic, when in fact it was dismantling human rights in America, they're the people who gave us, they're the real fake news people. The very people that gave us the NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, telling us that the country was being defended against, you know, insurgents from inside and terrorists from the outside, were the very people who are shutting down civil rights in America right now and eviscerating our Constitution. They're the very same people who create propositions all over the country, in California, against labeling of GMO foods. They're the fake news artists. And they have the money to be able to sell their wares to us. They're fundamentalists in a modern guise, reducing very complex situations down to a few paltry tenets, identifying an enemy, dehumanizing the enemy, and making war on the enemy. The people who are giving us the real fake news, people who are giving this real fake news, are the people who are spying on us. There's a mass surveillance. Our phones are being tapped, our emails are being tapped. All this information is being kept in the cloud. That's interesting. I have nothing against the guy. I've never met the guy. I never will meet the guy. Is it Jeff Bezos, who's the owner of Amazon.com? He's the owner of the cloud. When you stack your stuff in the cloud, you know, you're using his stuff. The CIA recently paid him $600 million to store their stuff on the cloud. You think those two clouds aren't talking to each other or spying on each other? He spent $200 million buying the Washington Post recently. Do you think that Washington Post is going to be an outlet for real news or fake news? The spying technology is such at this stage that there is craft in outer space that can identify a banana slug and its spots on planet Earth from 200 miles out in space. That's the kind of technology, you know, which is being used to look after us. So I'm going to use a few metaphors, and I hope I don't disgust people by using these. The metaphors for the notion of fake news. The first one is a map. If you want to go into a strange place you've never been before, and you don't have a map, then you may get lost. But if you're a really good trekker, you know, you may also find it eventually. But you may get lost. Excuse me. However, if somebody gives you a bad map, then you probably will get lost. If you don't have a map, you may get lost. If you've got a bad map, you probably will get lost. And if you have an intentionally wrong map, somebody gave you a map knowing the wrong direction is, you certainly are going to get lost. So is it a choice between, you know, maybe getting lost, probably getting lost, or definitely getting lost? If you don't know, if you don't listen to the news, then the truth is, you may be uninformed. If you do listen to the news, the best thing you can hope for is that you'll be misinformed, that people will tell you stuff which isn't real because they believe it themselves to be real. The really bad thing is, if you listen to the news, you may be disinformed. People will tell you stuff that they know is a lie because they've got an agenda. So if you don't listen to the news, you may be uninformed. You listen to it, you're either going to be misinformed or disinformed. But there's a fourth alternative. You don't have to be uninformed. It's not a choice between being uninformed, misinformed, or disinformed. You can inform yourself. You can take some issue that is really important to you, and you can investigate it. You can go to all the sources and compare notes. And there will have to be some kind of orienting principles, because there's so much stuff out there. How are you going to know what's real and what's not real? I'll give you some very simple clues. If what you're investigating and the theories you're investigating make you feel loving and compassionate and reaching out to other people and allowing you to dissolve your prejudices, you're on to good news. You're on to what Jesus Christ is talking about. If what you're beginning to believe and investigate is making you angry or prejudicial or lose your compassion, you know, or be really violent against any other group of people, you're looking at the wrong stuff, or what you're being told isn't correct. So you have to have some kind of orienting principles as you go out there on your own, because you're not going to get it from the mass media. Worst case scenario, you're going to be misinformed. You know, best case scenario, you're going to be misinformed. Worst case scenario, you're going to be disinformed. So that's why I refer to you as a map, as an analogy. Let's say you're a cook. You love, making up stuff. You get a whole bunch of ingredients and you have no recipe, but you like to be creative. And you start playing around and you make a pie. Now, it may taste lousy. There's a possibility it may taste lousy. It may taste great, but it could taste lousy. However, if you have a bad recipe, it will definitely taste lousy, guaranteed taste lousy. And if one of the ingredients is actually a poison, not only will it taste lousy, you will die. So the question again is between being uninformed, misinformed, or disinformed. What do you want to do when you want to bake a tart? Try being creative and risk the possibility that it won't taste very well, or get a bad recipe and it's really going to taste horrible, or have a poisoned recipe and wind up dead. That's what the news media is like right now, in my opinion. And the last image, I hope it doesn't disgust people. All of you are lucky enough, as am I, to have a flush toilet. As a child growing up, I did not have a flush toilet for the first 6 years of my life. In Africa, mostly we didn't have flush toilets. We had long drops. So a flush toilet is this amazing device where, after you've done your business, you press a handle, and all of the stuff, the gunk, is sucked into the sewage system. Suppose you had a toilet and you discovered that every time you flushed the handle, not only did it not get rid of the stuff you just deposited, but actually it sucked stuff up from the sewage system in the city and threw it out into your toilet and it flowed off into your sitting room and dining room. Because that's what's happening in the sitting rooms of America. Every time you hit the remote, you're pushing a toilet that's discharging bilge into your sitting room. You want to do it? You want to sit in the bilge? Go ahead. Be my guest. Yeah. It's not going to clear. It's not going to clear your mind. It's not going to tell you what the facts are. It's not going to point you towards the light. It's going to flood your mind with all kinds of bilge from one side or the other side and make you angry, finally. Section E, outrage. There's extraordinary outrage in our country right now about a whole bunch of made-up mishigas. One of them being that Russia hacked our elections and determined who we are going to have for president. There's not an iota of evidence that's ever been adduced that that's true. Not an iota of evidence. What did come out is the extraordinary intrigue happening within the electoral process in our country. So it's the equivalent of, to use a very graphic illustration, it's the equivalent of a family in which the parents are sexually molesting the children for years and years and years. And finally, one of the children has the courage to tell a teacher what's happening. And the teacher reports to the authorities. And the parents find out. And rather than being contrite about what they're actually doing to the kids, they suspect a neighbor of actually busting them. And they start making war. And they start pointing fingers at the neighbor. Bad, 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 bad. You're the cause of creating this, unhappiness in our family. Ignoring completely that the molestation is the issue. It's not who busted them or who reported the news. It's the fact that, the molestation was happening. That's what's happening in our country right now. And we have this outlet that Russia are the bad guys, and they did it. They interfered in our election. Now, not only is it not that there's no evidence to support that, it's utter hypocrisy on our part. If you look at our track record and how we have interfered in the electoral processes of other democracies in the world, you only have to go back to the 1960s to find this extraordinary trail of carnage, beginning in the Belgian Congo in 1960. The first democratically elected leader in Africa was a guy called Patrice Lumumba, formerly the Belgian Congo, an extraordinary individual who immediately set about nationalizing the resources of the country. There are tremendous gold reserves and precious metal reserves, diamonds, in the Belgian Congo. He wanted to nationalize them and feed the profits into the country and create infrastructure. One of the last acts of the Eisenhower government, and I have no idea, I cannot say whether Eisenhower was privy to it or even aware of it, one of the last acts of his regime before he handed over to John F. Kennedy in early 1961 was to have Patrice Lumumba abducted, tortured, and assassinated, and a stooge put in his place who became a multi-billionaire on the heads of cooperation with Western corporations. From then, from the 60s onwards, all over South and Central America, our CIA has infiltrated, toppled democratically elected leaders, and installed puppet regimes. And we have the chutzpah to claim that Russia hacked and influenced the outcome of our recent elections. I mean, the hypocrisy is astounding. Instead of looking at the child molestation that's happening in our country, we're pointing at the Russians claiming they're the guys who busted us. You know, let's go get them. Forget about the kids that we're molesting. That's not the issue. The issue is there's a made-up enemy that we can kind of divert attention to. When I was living in Kenya in the 70s and the 80s, Idi Amin came to power in Uganda. And Idi Amin killed somewhere between 300,000 and 500,000 of his own people in tribal conflict. So badly that the huge big electrical power station at Jinja on Lake Kisumu, which provided electricity for Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda, got clogged up with dead bodies. And for several weeks, we had no electricity in Kenya, or in Uganda, or Tanzania, because there were so many dead bodies clogging up the works that the machines couldn't work. At this period of time, Idi Amin was elected the chairman of the OAU, the Organization of African Unity. It's a pan-African congress involving all the free countries in Africa, and every year they would elect a kind of a titular head. And Idi Amin was elected the head of this organization during this period of time. At the same period of time, he was pointing fingers at South Africa, where apartheid was in full swing. And he was claiming that these savage white people were oppressing the blacks in South Africa. And indeed they were. It needed to be pointed out. But that was 2,500 miles south of us. He was killing 300,000 of his own people, and not a single African leader stood up, you know, and interrogated him about it. And he's diverting the attention to the bad guys in South Africa. And there were bad guys in South Africa. But he was killing 300,000 of his own people, and nobody said anything. What's happening to the millions of lives that we're destroying as a country? We and our European allies, where we're getting all exercised about the fact that Russia hacked our election, which is totally made up. There's no evidence even to support that. So forget the fact that we molested our children, and let's focus on who busted us, who told the story. So if we're going to get outraged, guys, let's get outraged at the right targets. Section F, I call Overcoming the Programming. From the time we're born as little children, we're programmed. For the first 7 years of a child's life, they're like wet concrete. They're absorbing the kind of the belief system and the prejudices and the memes of the culture without any ability to differentiate between what's true and what's not true. So the great meme enforcers in the child's life are parents, families, teachers, and friends. And the great enforcers of the memes during adolescence are the authorities, whoever we perceive those to be, whether they're religious figures or politicians or the mass media. But they're certainly, you know, they're certainly enforcing the program. So from 1 to 7 particularly, we're wet concrete, and we take aboard as gospel everything we're told to be true. And that becomes our basic modus operandi for the rest of our lives. We begin to judge all other experiences on the basis of this pre-digested, you know, programming of ours. By age 6 or 7, it changes a little bit. We've now developed the ability to reason. And now we can understand rules and roles for the first time ever. We're assigned roles and we're given rules. And now we begin to follow these. These are the next stage of the programming. These are the rules you have to follow, and these are the roles you have to fulfill. So from 6 to 12, we keep rules and we adopt roles. About age 12, something very interesting happens, is that we move into puberty. And for the first time ever, we begin to think self-reflectively. We can now begin to kind of look at our own culture and ask questions like, why are we sending drones across the world to kill people? Or why are we at war? Why are there refugees, you know, trying to get into our country right now? And at this stage, society tries to shut us down. Societies educate us until age 12 by programming us. And after that, the education stops. The programming continues through mass media, but they don't want us developing intellectually any further than that. They don't want us going beyond. We start off life egocentrically, little kids. We develop then ethnocentricity. We're members of the tribe. The tribe never wants us to go beyond ethnocentricity. The notion of ecocentricity, where we think as a globe, our cosmocentricity, where we think as a cosmos, that's out of bounds. We're not allowed to go there. So we shut down kids at that stage. We don't allow them. And the prophets who come among us and begin to point out the inadequacy of this, these are the people whom we assassinate. These are the Martin Luther King Juniors. So finally, I want to say, becoming a meme maker, what do we need to do? There are three ways, I believe, that we make decisions. We make decisions unconsciously, we make decisions consciously, and we make decisions super consciously. What does most of our decisions are unconscious decisions. There's a program running under the surface constantly that's telling us what to do, what choices to make. So the unconscious makes decisions on the basis of program, you know, embedded programs. There is no free will when you make an unconscious decision, and you're operating on the basis of old internalized propaganda. The vast bulk of our decisions are made at the unconscious level. So they're pre-programmed, they're the basis of old propaganda, and there is zero free will involved in an unconscious decision. The next level of decision making is conscious decision making. Now we're semi-free, but we're being buffeted by current propaganda. So even as we attempt to make conscious decisions today, we're buffeted with a whole bunch of competing, you know, belief systems and ideas. And we have to try to find our way in the midst of all of this. So we're only semi-free, but we're being bombarded with current propaganda. And then the third kind of decision-making, and maybe, I don't know, maybe 5% of the population are at that stage. Maybe the Mahatma Gandhis or the Thich Nhat Hanhs or the Dalai Lamas are at that stage, who are making decisions from a superconscious state in which there is total freedom, not just free will, freedom. And I differentiated between those the first day. Free will is the ability to do as I please. Freedom is the ability to do as pleases God. So the superconscious person, a person who's making decisions from a superconscious level, is a totally free individual. They're operating from the higher self, and there is zero propaganda involved in the decision-making processes. So to rephrase, I'm going to end this section. I'm totally convinced that this little group of people in this room tonight is here by preconception contract. We've been together, guys, many, many times before. We've been in world situations which seemed catastrophic at the time. Every one of us is here by choice. We're in a world, we knew the track records of everybody in this room, how we'd behave as a group, what our strengths as individuals were, what our weaknesses as individuals were, and we said yes to that agreement. We knew exactly what our mission was, and we knew exactly what time we were, you know, coming in at, parachuting in to the world situation. So we got a lot of choices now. We can bitch, we can bury our head in the sand, we can become hopeless or angry, or we can say, this is why I came. Here I am, Lord. Send me. So I'd like to break for 15 minutes, guys. Come back at 20 after. And then I want everybody else to do the talking. I want us to share our wisdom, our experiences, our hope, and our vision for our world and for our country. So there are 35 of us, you know, gathered together for this search. And I reckon that probably the average age is in the high 50s, which means there's over 2,000 years of experience in this room.
Wow, that's shocking.
It's very impressive, because we've come very, very different paths from very, very different places. You know, we bring an extraordinary plethora of wisdom with us. And that's what I want us to begin sharing with each other now for the next hour, until supper time. I want you, drawing on the wisdom of your journey, to begin sharing with us, you know, whatever you want to contribute to the conversation today. John.
Well, I know that this has been a difficult lecture to speak about.
Could you speak up?
Yeah, it's been a difficult lecture to speak about. For Sean, it's been hard to hear a lot of what he's saying. And it's been a hard time to listen to the news and to be in this country at this time. And I did go on a news diet as best as I could, maybe about 2 months ago, maybe a little longer than that. I wasn't pure on it. I also have a husband who is used to read 3 newspapers a day, the Irish Times, the New York Times, and the San Francisco Chronicle. He's backed off, but he's watching an awful lot of news. So I can't walk into a room and say, turn that off right now, honey. That doesn't work. So I did hear some things that were upsetting to me, and some things that I felt I had to act on. And through one of those, I did go to see Jack Speer at a local town hall, and I got to stand up and say something, and I was very glad I did. So that wasn't really a great diet. But the thing of really trying to step back from all of this, and it being difficult anyway, was I've had to really focus in on my spirituality. I've been praying more. I've been praying the rosary more. I've discovered that as wound up as I've been getting, if I go, even with a minimal amount of whatever I'm seeing, if I go do something where I can really make a difference for somebody that's really, really solid, or an animal or something, but make a difference, it's really, really solid, that brings me into another place and it alleviates this. So I found that corner is very necessary for me right now. And, you know, my mom passed away right around at the same time of all this, so there's some interweaving of that is, I'm kind of deeply confused about a lot of this. So the best answers for me are spirituality, right now, prayer, going to church, and you have provided the big log that's been in my eye that I didn't know was there. I don't want to see it. I don't like it. It makes me cry. But if that's the reality, then that's the reality. And I'm not sure about these memes and how to progress with them. I'm hoping that as I listen more, I'll understand. But I walked out of both these these lectures today just going, holy shit. it's like, oh dear God. And that's why I came. Because I want to understand, and if I can make a difference in a way that's not stupid and adding worse, I'm seeing that that would be a good idea. But the simplicity that I found of, and also some of my basic core things, trying to do some artwork to associate with some of the things that I need for myself, but to find a way to deal with this that is in alignment.
Brilliant.
Not so far off.
Good. Great, Joanna. Thanks a million.
So I just wanted to say something about the news fast, which is that as soon as I stopped watching the news, I noticed how different I felt.
Yes.
That the television in general, and news in particular, has a way of draining me. I don't know about anybody else. Absolutely draining me. So then when you don't see that, it allows you to have more energy to do the kinds of things you're talking about. You can think your life becomes focused back on now and what your life is and who's around you and what you can do in town or wherever to make a difference for an individual. And stop worrying about things that may or may not be true and just not having your energy go, you know, in that comment, you know, part of that morass of murky whatever that is. And the more I'm away from the news, the more quickly when I walk through the room and the television is on, which in my house it always is, the more quickly I react to, like, oh, there it is again. You know, and it's just like, you know, it's like you have to, it's like backing off to something you shouldn't be eating or drinking or something, and then suddenly you have a taste of it and it's like too much, you know, immediately. So I find it to be really energizing to not be allowing my that much of my energy to be just wasted, really. Mm-hmm. Wasted in that way. But I do have this question about a desire to be informed. Mm-hmm. So how do we find what's true?
That's the key piece, because, you know, it's not good to be uninformed. It's actually worse to be misinformed, and worst of all to be disinformed, but it's not good to be uninformed. So we have to inform ourselves. The question is, are there ways of doing it which don't involve sitting, you know, in front of the toilet bowl and pushing the lever? And there are, you know, and it's there's lots of ways of making the searches. But you have to have some kind of guiding principles when you're making your searches, because the overpowering amount of views out there on any topic, you know, you're going to be lost. So you have to have some kind of orienting principles. It's like you're going to meet somebody, somebody set you up for a blind date, and you have no idea what the guy looks like. And he says to you, well, I'm going to wear a bowler hat. So you're walking down the streets, you know, to a designated meeting spot, and you're looking for a guy with a bowler hat. So you're not going to go up and introduce yourself to a guy wearing a fez, you know, or wearing a kind of a skull cap. You're looking for the guy with the bowler cap. So you're not going to be distracted by girls who are wearing different kinds of headdress. The same thing is true in the search. If you know that you're looking for something that's going to bring peace and love and compassion, you know, and that's not going to bring you into prejudice of various kinds, you're going to see quickly who's wearing a bowler hat and who's not wearing a bowler hat. But you have to identify for yourself what are those search criteria that you're going to utilize. So you have to make out a list for yourself that says to me, I know this is the truth because it'll create this feeling within me. And you identify yourself what those feelings are that make you feel spiritual, loving, you know, part of unity consciousness on the road to your Buddha nature. You create those lists of those criteria, and then you start your search, whether you're on the internet, or you start digging the newspapers, or you start reading books, or whatever it is that you need to do in order to inform yourself. But you have to have these guiding principles, otherwise you're going to fall in love with a guy with a fez.
Might you be willing to
recommend a specific source, you know, some of the best news sources from your perspective? I know that we have to find what resonates with each one of us.
Otherwise, I'm just inviting you to into my biases. Mm-hmm. But I can, there are things, places I like to listen to news. Yes. Like Ingrid knows this one well. Queries for Ingrid, Coast to Coast. It's a night program. I download them onto my iPad and when I'm traveling up and down to Palo Alto, I listen to this kind of stuff. There is a guy called Dark Journalist. There's a group called Forbidden Knowledge, which will talk about stuff that other people won't talk about. So there are some of the sources that I tend to investigate. But then I go off and I do my own internet searches on the basis of stuff I pick up from these, and I investigate. You know what feels really good to me. You know, what leaves me feeling loving and compassionate at the end of a thing? What feels to me like it's just somebody trying to sell a product or somebody trying to whip up, foment some kind of unease? But you got to create your own list, because you can't import my biases. I don't want you to do that. Yeah. So, listen to this. Sorry, Pat.
That's all right. I know someone who has done a lot of research over the last 9 years about, he lost all of his money in the 2008 crash, and he's a financial, he has a doctorate in finance, and he couldn't believe it, so he started researching and discovering the corporate manipulation of Wall Street, and he talks to me about it, and I'm pretty convinced. And he's found really obscure sources that are pretty much suppressed, but it makes him really angry. So, you know, I'm understanding what you're saying about looking for peace, love. Is the problem that he doesn't set out with that intention, or, I mean, it seems like he's finding the truth, and it's not bringing him peace.
Yes.
I mean, he's just
yes.
saying, we ought to hang these people, they're criminals.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
he's just ranting about it. And I keep saying, calm down, you're not doing you or yourself or anyone any good by just getting into the same negativity. But it just, I mean, you can understand he lost his life savings.
Totally.
And he's identified the people who did it and who are still doing it over and over and
Absolutely.
Over again. Mm-hmm. And nobody will listen to him.
Right. So I totally get it. And the tendency is to get angry. And that's the importance of, you know, and they're going to be focusing for the rest of the retreat on this, the next three lectures. You have to have a spirituality, because when you encounter that level of darkness, you're either going to be so incensed by the horrors that are happening, or you're going to get sucked into it yourself. If you're not coming from a place of light, and as I was just meditating down there for the last 15 minutes, I went back to this image that I spoke about earlier this evening, that, you know, light does not create darkness. When you shine light into something, it doesn't create the darkness. What it does is, like, the darkness, you know, coagulates, you know, and hides. So I had this image of coming into a room with a big dresser in the middle of the room. And I shine the light on this, a dark, totally dark room. I shine the light on the dresser. What happens? All the darkness in the room runs around and hides behind the back of the dresser. So I run around the back of the dresser, and I shine the light in the back of the dresser. What happens? All the light goes around and hides in front of the dresser. I can run to the left-hand side of the dresser and I shine the light on the left-hand side. All the darkness in the room retreats to the right-hand side. So I can spend my entire time chasing around the chest and drawers, and all I do is I'm chasing the darkness around and around, but I'm not affecting it. I got to remove the obstacle. The obstacle is what creates the darkness when it meets the light. So as long as the obstacle is there, there's going to be darkness hiding out. No matter how much and how quickly I run around, I'll never catch up with the darkness. So what is the light that I bring to the search? It's not just my intellect. I'm not just trying to figure out who are the bad guys and how are they doing it. I'm bringing in a whole spirituality that says, this is my brother. He's not my enemy. He's my brother who's gotten the jigsaw puzzle wrong. How do I respond to that? I can confront him, and I maybe need to confront him, but I need to do it from a place of love. As long as, you know, this is Christ's great insight. Love your enemy. The greatest way of making a friend of your enemy, you know, is by making him your sister or your brother. You're not going to humiliate him into being obedient or being nicer. You're only going to kind of, you're going to seduce him into it by your spirituality. So if you're not coming from a spiritual place, no matter how much investigation you do, it's either going to get you sucked into it because you're mired in that kind of energy for so long, or it's going to make you really, really mad because there's so much shit happening out there. So if you're not operating from light yourself, then don't even bother putting on the torch.
I have a metaphor. So when you were talking about shining at the light at this dresser drawer, I was thinking the answer really is community. So if you have multiple people with multiple lights, and you're willing to see it from these different points of view, so you're all shining the light, and the shadows go away if you have multiple lights.
I love it.
So that was the image that came to me.
Awesome. Brilliant.
So I have a hopeful story I'd like to share with the group, and it's a very recent story that just happened over the last few days for me. There's a group that I belong to called Integral Transformative Practice, and Mary Kate's part of the group, and a number of you in the room have been part of this community. And one of the most recent memes that this group has been working with is called evolutionary love. And it's this idea that the elemental driver of evolution, both cosmic and human, is this evolutionary love. And there's a definition here that I'd like to read, and it comes from Adam Crabtree, who's a university professor, and Julia Mossbridge, who's a research scientist at the Institute of Noetic Science. And there's a number of people at Esalen that are also working with this. So evolutionary love is the heartfelt, benevolent desire that everyone, ourselves, others, and all that exists in the universe reaches their greatest possible fulfillment, whatever that may prove to be. This love is freely given with no consideration of merit, with no strings attached, with no expectation of return. And it is a love that motivates supportive action in the one who loves. One of the things that, so we recently had a retreat that started on Friday, went Saturday, and then just ended yesterday. And the theme of our retreat was embodied inquiry. And one of the things that I felt was important in trying to look at shadows was to really bring in love. That it's not really possible to look at shadow unless love and safety is present. So I changed the program on Friday night to include this exploration of evolutionary love. And I was really surprised that I had an objection. There was somebody who really vehemently said, no, you're taking over here, you're bringing in this concept from up high, from integral transformative practice, it's not appropriate for you to do this. And so what I did is I explained to this person about this concept, and then, you know, I used a lot of skills from Sean. So when I first saw him, I gave him a hug and continued to shower him with love. And over the weekend, you know, he really let go of his ideas, his preconceived ideas about what he was objecting to. And I found out part of it was he was the one that came up with this idea of embodied inquiry. So he was very invested in, this is the program that I had planned for the weekend, and this idea of evolutionary love just really didn't fit in. But by the end of the weekend, he really understood, you know, creating an environment of safety allowed us to really look deeper at shadow, really as a community, having light shined on these dark places and supporting one another was really helpful. So introducing this new meme, it was something that, I mean, for me, there were challenges to try and introduce it. And I think that, you know, as we look at all of these topics that we're bringing up this weekend, that's what we need to do, is we need to use our creativity to bring up these new memes like love. How can we weave this into everything that we're doing, new situations?
Pardon my question. Good. Bill.
You know, one of the things that sort of struck me was that if we find these sources that fill us with love and kindness and do not rile us up, how do we know we're getting the truth? Just because it makes us feel good doesn't necessarily mean it's any more true than the things that make me so angry that I want to spit. I'm just asking these questions because it just sort of, sometimes I just have a hard time finding those sources that I can believe, but are not just sort of placating me to make me feel good.
That's the key, Bill. You put your finger right on it. Absolutely. Because there's a huge difference between feeling good and feeling love. They're very different. Feeling good is precisely letting me off the hook. I don't need to do anything anymore, you know. Feeling love is I'm not going to have to stretch into my divinity and recognize the divinity of the other, and I'm going to have to get off my butt and start doing stuff, whether it's as what Johanna says, simple things like, you know, saying hi to the postman or whatever it is. So it's also important to understand that I think there are four different kinds of love. I call them the four C's. The first kind of love is, confirmation, where you give said to somebody, attaboy, you're doing a great job, fabulous. So you're loving them by supporting what they're doing. The second kind of love I call complementary love. We're members of a team, and I'm able to do one function, and you're able to do the other function, and I'm loving you by playing my part in the team, supporting the team. The third kind of love I call compensatory love, where we're members of a team again, but you drop the ball, you know, and I pick it up on your behalf, you know, and hand it back to you. So I'm making up for some mistake that you made, or you're making up for some lack in my abilities, and together we're creating a team effort. And the fourth kind of love is, fourth C, is confrontation or challenge, where I say what you're doing is not okay. You cannot do this, and you know you can get quite energized by it. But there's a big difference between being energized and being angry. So you've got to confront evil where you see it, and you've got to take practical steps to try to take people out of positions of power who are abusing that, you know, or take children out of situations where they're in danger. So you have to make practical decisions by confronting real life situations, but never from a place of anger. So feeling good and feeling love are very different. Feeling good masquerades as feeling love. They're very, very different. Because feeling good just lets you off the hook, exactly as you said. So somebody else was trying again before. Ingrid was next, and then Christine. Ingrid.
Well, I really love the metaphor of the hero's journey.
Okay.
That we all have passion and purpose to be here and to be alive. And that we have the call to be out in the world, to be part of the world, and to bring our unique contribution. And I really like what Bashar says, to go for your greatest excitement. That's always going to keep you on your pathway, and you're going to meet the people and connect where you need to connect. Joseph Campbell said, follow your bliss. And Abraham says, go for your joy. So that's a very big thing that I really try to anchor into. One time when you were doing the 2012 thing, you said we had to develop a cosmology. And the only thing that I've really seen spiritually that summarizes it and transmits so much knowledge is the yin and yang symbol. So it's a circle, and it has the light and the dark, and it's evolving, and then it's descending. And so what I realized for me to use my ascending thing is asking most benevolent outcomes for anything I want or don't want. I ask the angels, I ask my higher self, and I say, angels, I need this or I want this. But I put it out with a most benevolent outcome. I don't know what that's going to look like, but the universe does. And because of that, I have so much synchronicity, and wonderful things keep flowing into my life, because I'm asking for a lot all the time. You can do it 24/7, you can't over-ask. But you put the MBO on it. So one example was I had really shitty neighbors, I couldn't stand them, I hated them, hostility, and I just said, God, I wish they'd just, you know, get evicted, but it was all this negativity. So I said, I can't get rid of them that way. I say, well, I've got to wish him into a nicer environment, into a bigger garage, into a better place. Within 2 weeks, they were gone. So hopefully they got the better place. But I mean, that's kind of a little example where you start to think of other better options for all involved. Now, sometimes some things are so painful and so despairing and so we can't understand it. And that's where the ho'oponopono comes in, where we have to forgive. And the sacred Hawaiian huna technique, as you say, I'm sorry, please forgive me, I love you, and thank you. Because you're just being shown how you're off path and you're not in your God self. And so, and you can even say that through gritted teeth. You know what I'm saying? You don't even have to mean it when you say it. Seriously, just thinking the thought form, I'm sorry, forgive me, I love you, and thank you, are so powerful. It transmutes things. And so those things have really helped me stay positive and have a good time doing all my life activities and feeling that I'm being really guided by my higher self and so many others.
Brilliant, brilliant. Thanks a million. Thanks a million, Dad. Thank you. Christine.
I want to share about the Global Coherence Project because it has given me a lot of hope. I mean, it's really on 7 times. Has anybody heard of Heart Math or Global Coherence?
Yes.
And I've actually been part of a community where it's like, you know, being both and, you know, not pushing away the anger or being with the emotions, and also through, you know, the heart intelligence, because the heart is so much bigger, the vibration of the heart, that it knows the truth. So it's like when you were saying, you know, about the truth, what is the truth, and it's, there's so much that's going out, and I find the news fast for me has been essential to really stay grounded. And I also have found that being part of this global coherence is it's about really breathing into the heart and doing practices through the heart, and then they have shown, and you can see it very clearly on different instruments, that it's contagious, so that, you know, they're really seeing that whole populations, it's like the TM community, transcendental meditators, that when you're in coherence, like when I'm resonating here in coherence, then you can feel it and it radiates out to everyone. And that intelligent really knows whatever it is that's meant to happen. It's like the ho'opono or, you know, the grace all of a sudden. So it's like the brain waves change and the heart changes, but it's about really, for myself, it's about really staying with the heart and just listening to the heart. But also when the practice is basically breathing in and out through the heart and focusing on something that you forgive in yourself. You know, you send compassion and forgiveness to yourself, and then we send it out to the person next to us and to everyone around us in the room and wherever, the whole community. And each person gets it. When we're in coherence, in that coherent heart, the whole lower brain centers change. You go to the higher brain center and options open up. It's like a whole opening to a whole different energetic field. So if I just practice that, I don't have to do anything else except just be in my own heart with that coherent space, then it's like it seems that it's impacting. People don't even have to know about it. It's just the whole community, just like, you know, with what you're teaching, the vibrations go out. But it also really shifts the impact of the news, you know, because it impacts whatever I'm hearing, or it impacts a lot of things. It's like going back, is this really true, that from that coherent heart? And the answer is very clear whether it's true or not, or what it is. But I think it's almost like a way to stay sane in the midst of all of this confusion and still feel like I can do something to make a difference, to stay in that and be focused on the heart intelligence. And there's a whole program online, if you go to HeartMath, it teaches you how to do it, very simple, and how to radiate compassion to yourself and love first and then to everyone else and just stay in that field. And it's made a big difference in my life to be present with that.
Thanks a million, Christine.
Heart Math?
Thanks a million.
Heart Math.
Heart Math.
Yeah, if you go to just Google heart math, the basic techniques are all there online now, which is really great, and you can actually do it, and then you can measure it. There's tools, very simple tools, you can measure how your brain changes, how your body changes, mm-hmm. and the effect it has on all the chemicals in the brain, mm-hmm. because all of this stress is so depleting, and then there's so many emotions, and it allows you to really be clear on what's really true for myself. Helped me to be really clear on that.
Thanks, Christy. Thank Bill.
That is something I struggle with, and it would be interesting to hear what others do with this. But, you know, since I'm kind of a introvert, not a natural leader or ass-kicker type, when I kind of need an emotional impetus sometimes to take action against a problem or an injustice. So, you know, when I feel some sort of moral outrage, then I can be motivated to do something. But once I'm in that state, it's hard enough to get into the divide and conquer us versus them enemy type of mentality. So I try to think of an effective way to do that without posing an enemy of some sort. And I'm just interested to hear how others deal with that.
Anybody? Michael, you want to pick up on that?
So I started working with the elements, so fire, water, earth, and air. And so when I find this sort of motivation or outrage, I kind of identify that with energy, and then really working with fire. But sometimes what fire takes is this outward action and force, and not necessarily, you know, being righteous about it, but just knowing from a balanced place that this is the right action that I need to take. And then really then taking a step forward with that sort of energy is what is helpful for me. And so it's a real grounded place, but then taking action as opposed to really having to push against another force. It's really taking, I think, moving in the right direction, taking the right step. That's what's been helpful for me.
So, say you have to get into
that. Sometimes it's important to, if you see evil, not necessarily to engage with it, mm-hmm. but to see that it's there, let it know that you see it. I mean, it can be so overwhelming that you may not be called to, you know, launch those things like crusade, but just, you know, shining your flashlight there, it knows.
Okay. Susie?
I live by this, that you can't control anyone else's behavior. You can only control your response to it. And, you know, sometimes it works really well, and sometimes, you know, it doesn't, because, you know, sometimes you have to really monitor your response. But I recently just had a really negative interaction with my sister, who's a, you know, huge Trump supporter. And we were having this conversation that was, on my part, tempered, because she can fly off. And then she made a comment about, you know, people going back to their own country, and I stopped her and I said, "You and I are on completely different sides on this. I don't think we should have this conversation." She continued, and I said, I'm warning you right now that I will hang up the phone if you continue with this conversation." And she continued. So I hung up. You know, and unfortunately I think she's oblivious to it. I'm struggling with it, and she's probably oblivious to it. But I mean, I feel like that's the kind of, you know, you can only control your response. That was my response, but now I have to work with my response, you know, because it's not necessarily
the first response is often some kind of pushback, mm-hmm. sarcasm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got to be smart enough to know that, well, I'll just wait a couple hours and then another day before responding.
Right.
But I knew if I engaged in that conversation, it exploded.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I felt it was better for both of us to just, you know, hang on.
Sharon?
In response to that, it reminds me of the something that
Dreadful Melchizedek said, what resists persists. And the more we push, the more we're going to get back. And that we're never going to win a battle, forget the battles in the first place, is to embrace our own darkness and try to deal with it. And also remember, like Sean said, that they aren't our enemies, they're our brothers who got the wrong puzzle pieces arranged. And that was such a beautiful thing that was mentioned about the benevolent desire for them to reach their greatest possible fulfillment with no strings or expectations.
That's Ingrid.
It was Mike. And I remember Marie Diamond saying, you know, when there was a previous election, she said, you know, people get really angry at me when I tell them to send love to Bush at the time. And she said, can you imagine? I mean, remember, energy is energy, and it's felt. When millions of people send hate to Trump, imagine how shitty he feels. He is our brother, and he's a narcissistic one, too. I mean, we should look at our own narcissism within ourselves, and, you know, whatever our thing is. But I think we constantly have to remind ourselves that we're just increasing the negativity between ourselves when we project our anger back. We're mirrors of each other, and he's there to remind us of where we are narcissistic, where we're, you know, not really true or honest with ourselves. And the same easy for me. I don't like to space myself. And self-love is so predominantly necessary right now. I mean, it always has been. But we it's amazing how much people try to give to others in spite of them hating themselves. I give my rant and rave about myself, you know, a lot. I get really angry at my failures and my weaknesses and all. But we have to start there, because we really limit our capability to love others. And you have a lot of love with it. You're not a jerk. You have so much goodness within you. And you need to look at yourself in the mirror and tell yourself, you know, I forgive you. I'm sorry. And I do that to myself a lot lately. I'm sorry. Please forgive me, Sharon. I love you, and I thank you, and I'm going to, you know, keep working at this. But, we love you.
Love that. Feel the love. Feel the love. That's it.
As a psychologist, you know, what we're all talking about here is no matter what life's experiences or how old you get, you still, the go-to place is the reptilian brain. Okay. I mean, the fight or flight, and it can be over politics, it can be personal frontals or injustices, but how do we, and in retrospect, you can go to the frontal cortex, but the trick is it in our DNA, is it in our culture, the water we drink? I mean, that is invariably the go-to place. So, I mean, you can describe it in many different ways, but it is the fight or flight. Political scene has really, you know, just, that's all that's there. There's no frontal cortex anymore.
So you're absolutely right, Nancy. So let me just make one quick comment on that. With the advent of advertising was brought to a whole new level by actually a nephew of Freud's. Bernays, you know, who brought, you know, the ability to market products to an extraordinary level. He was the guy responsible for women beginning to smoke. He created a campaign where it was really, really cool, great-looking models with cigarettes at a time when women did not smoke. It was totally countercultural. He made it cool for women to smoke. What you'll find out is that subtle clues can totally screw your behavior. I heard a very, very interesting experiment a few weeks ago where a psychologist is sitting in an office and he's trying to find out what people's political positions are, whether they fall into the conservative camp or liberal camp. And by a very, very simple technique, they come into an office, he's going to ask them a set number of questions. And he puts a bottle of hand sanitizer on the table. You squeeze onto your hand and rub your hands. If there's a hand sanitizer on the table, people are going to skew their responses towards the conservative end, because they're suddenly, what's that doing there? There are germs in this place, be on your guard, back up here. He'll bring the same people back 2 months later, and there's no sand sanitizer on the table. He'll ask them exactly the same list of questions, and they move towards the liberal end of it.
Wow.
You know. So literally just putting a physical object in your line of view can skew whether you're going to engage the hindbrain right now or the forebrain right now. And these people know that. The people who are marketing these kinds of products, and I don't mean just consumer products, I mean the news media, there are psychologists trained specifically knowing how to manipulate people's fears and people's needs. And when you're hearing news, you have no idea what kind of science has been built into the way the stuff has been presented and the order which it's been doing. It's geared towards the hindbrain. Make them afraid. Make them xenophobic. Make them anxious. Make them depressed. Anything to do except love. So you're absolutely true. They're gearing the product towards the hindbrain. Somebody else was trying to get in. Tom.
Yeah, I have a fairly simple two-level dichotomy of how I work. On the basic level, comes from a belief, I think it's very consistent with your stuff, that all minds are connected. Now, when we're in a state of fear, we may not know we're connected to the other people. In fact, we think we're not. But when you can move towards love, that connection can become a little more obvious. Okay, what is it that I know enough to do? At this point, I can recognize my thoughts and feelings that are loving and the ones that are fearful. That's within my capability. That's what my little laptop can do. So I can make those choices. And I can either send love to somebody else's brain, or I can send fear. Okay, how about the second level? The second level is not where I'm connecting to somebody else's brain, sort of the...
Energetically?
Yeah, energetically. It's when I decide that, or I know that it's probably important that I actually do something, that there's some behavior I manifest exteriorly. Mm-hmm. Am I bright enough to know all the factors that are going on in this world and on around me, not only in my life, but also in the person that I'm relating to? Hell no. How can I make a decision to make actions, to take an action in that? Well, the way I describe it, and I've heard it described in several different ways, is to me, my higher self is the Holy Spirit. Now that's a being, that's an entity, whatever you want to call it, it's part of God, that actually understands what's going on in this world, this physical world, what would be the best outcome and the best way for everybody. And I basically say, hey, you want me to do something? I'm more than willing to, but I need a little guidance here. I'm not going to make the decision on my own. You know, it might wind up in a very tense situation where people are being hurt, where I can get the guidance to shoot somebody to protect others. I mean, that's a possibility, as well as to go up to them and, despite the fact they have a gun in their hands, talk to them about, you know, do you really want... But I'm just not capable of making those decisions on my own little brain. Mm-hmm. And I really want guidance. And I ask for, I don't always get it, but when I get it, I have the confidence to go with it. When I don't get it, I sort of pray a little more and sit quietly, because I'd rather be passive than be part of the problem. And my only point is that this is something I can do with my own capabilities, and that's recognize the difference between love and fear and act on love. And there's something above that which involves physical actions that I'm not capable of independently making the decision on. And I've got to pray for guidance. And when I get it, great. And when I don't get it, I better wait until I get some guidance. Better pray a little bit more. Because I just don't want to screw things up.
Sounds good.
That's my story. Excellent. Great.
You know, one thing that I have noticed, and you do get your news over the internet, and I hope everyone is kind of aware of this, is that they are wise enough to send you the news you want to read.
Absolutely.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
So you have to break that train. And so we'll see if we can do that.
Brilliant. Absolutely. Right. Yeah.
But you absolutely get exactly when you're wound up tighter to drum, you're going to get more news that's going to do that to you.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And they also, like when they try to sell you something, if I look on the internet, do a search, I'm looking for some kind of thing, for the next 3 weeks, I'm going to get advertisements of that stuff, and I'm going, guys, I don't need this anymore.
Totally. Totally. Absolutely. Karen, sorry, go ahead, Kim.
When I received your email to take a news fast, it was about the time that I was hearing, you know, my practice or my habit, I guess, rather, is driving back and forth to work. I would listen to NPR, BBC, whatever shows came on there. And I heard something that related to all of the forces were aligning with the newly elected president and all that was going on around the world, that this is the way Nazi Germany came to power. Mm. And I was like, oh my God, I can't buy into all of this. This is just getting ridiculous to listen. And I would come away from that, I'd be walking into work from parking my car and feeling so anxious and upset and really feeling depressed, you know, and overwhelmed and powerless to do anything. What the hell can I do? You know, the powers that be are so powerful, and I'm just this little individual trying to walk a straight line, you know. So as an alternative to listening to the news back and forth to work, I decided that I would listen to books on tape. And one of the first books that I listened to, unconsciously not related to that last news story I heard, was The Hiding Place by Corrie Ten Boom.
The Hiding Place.
The Hiding Place by Corrie Ten Boom. It was a story that I'd read years ago, and I had a beautiful audio tape that I decided I wanted to listen to. And here's people put in a very desperate, sad situation as Nazi Germany invades Holland and takes prisoner. Mm-hmm. And Corrie Ten Boom has an amazing faith. And she is able to transcend all the evil around her through prayer and through scripture reading and through, you know, pulling people around her who are like-minded and, you know, getting them to pray with her and to build their faith together to overcome this as much as possible. That was their only real power. Mm-hmm. The Nazis couldn't take that away from them, certainly. So the message that I took away from that was that I needed to fall back on my spirituality and investigate that a little deeper. I also have recently become a fan of meditation.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, I think you touched on it a while ago when you said you must take the log out of your own eye if you can take the stick out of the others. And so a lot of my meditation is as I sit there and focus on my breath, and the thoughts come and they go and come back again, and I try to focus on three things. The first thing is how judgmental I am.
Mm-hmm.
Of everything around me, the slightest little things, and that I need to substitute that with more openness,
mm-hmm.
and keep an open heart and open mind and approach it with the love that I have. So that's the first thing I focus on. So I try not to be judgmental of myself,
mm-hmm.
and I try and recognize and be aware of these things in myself that breed prejudice or whatever bad word. And the second thing is to be more playful, to be more childlike. I still have four children at home, and I can watch them and just delight in their views of the world and the way they approach things. And I think as adults sometimes we get so focused and so serious that we forget about being playful. So, and the third thing that I try and focus on is gratitude. And it's so easy in these days when you're hearing all this negativity around you in the news, in your workplace, in your community, to forget about the little things that you're grateful for. And so I started saying, well, I'm going to tell myself I'm grateful for three things every day. Okay, I'm grateful for my family, I'm grateful that they're all healthy, and I'm grateful to be able to practice my faith or whatever, that I have this beautiful friend in San Francisco that has tried to bring me here for the last 4 years. So I'm
gonna turn this light off.
In this pocket. So that has helped me, and I feel like, you know, each of us needs to take our baby steps in our own way, moving forward with our loving nature and surround ourselves by Jesus people. This is a thought that I just borrowed from my daughter who went away on retreat as a senior in high school. And one of the things she learned at her Kairos retreat was that you surround yourself with Jesus people, those people who lift you up and bring out the best in you and focus on your optimism and loving nature, emulate Jesus. And I thought, yeah, you know, because so much of our world and our community is, you know, people bitching and complaining and talking about their anger and their negativism about what's going on around them, and it's contagious and it breeds more and more, and I just feel like that's not the road to go down. So I think this has helped open my eyes even more to what my place in this world, and I still don't know what those memes are that I can create. Maybe I can start with my children and move on from there.
Bring it to your meditation, Kim. Bring that question to your meditation. Dad.
I don't know if I can tell the story in a way that is like a consolidation of like 30 years where I worked, but I went to work for the federal government in 1978, and shortly after in 79, the man I worked for, he loved Corrie Ten Boom, so that's why I decided to tell how some pieces have come together for me. He returned from a trip to Langley Research Center, ashen white. He had been stricken. He just looked like a ghost. He was a tall, red-headed guy. And his friend at Langley ran the NASA's crashworthiness program. And he had taken him up to a lunar lander site and told him that that his wife had nearly married a former CIA career general named Bud Culligan, and that Bud Culligan was on the lam from the U.S. government, and that he knew who killed Kennedy, and that he'd kept six diaries, and the only reason he was alive was that he'd kept six diaries, and that Kennedy, JFK, was caught in a crossfire between the CIA and the mafia, and I mean, the CIA uses the mafia. But anyway, my boss was just, you know, and he told me this, and I just was also just floored and bothered about the country, because obviously it seemed true coming from such a close source. So I started reading, you know, the alternative literature on the assassinations, and was so disturbed over the years about our country, and felt that, well, like you, Sean, all the assassinations and manipulation in other countries, but they also took down the heroes of our generation, JFK, RFK, probably Martin Luther King. This is what I believe. So I have felt like, you know, would a Truth and Reconciliation Commission work? Because this is the shadow of our government, and no one, it's not being recognized. And it has fomented so many wars. Our foreign policy just brings all this tragedy, and it's not in the light. So for I thought, I just thought, oh, if we could just do Truth and Reconciliation and expose this and, you know, become a unified country with a clear or a forgiven conscience if possible. But then with Mr. Trump, I that was like another layer. And anyway, so I read a book once I retired called The Devil's Chessboard by David Talbot. He's a local fellow who started salon.com, and he goes back to the end of World War II when Alan Dulles and his brother, I think it was Alan Dulles, was working, you know, for Roosevelt in the State Department, and Roosevelt had issued an order for unconditional surrender by the Nazis, but Dulles already felt that the Soviet Union was going to be a bigger threat. And he disobeyed Roosevelt's orders, and he started helping Nazis come into the U.S. and setting up lines for them and working with them and employing them, because he saw the burgeoning communist threat as bigger. He thought in his mind it made sense to work with the Nazi prisoners or the people who were run, you know, as the war was ending. And so he disobeyed this executive order from Roosevelt and actually started developing his own foreign policy, doing these things. And so it's a very good book. It's long, but to me it was the first thing that helped me. I mean, it made me understand our foreign policy below the level that you're talking about, like the monetary manipulation by the oligarchy. But I saw then in Trump, I did see a kind of a second sight, kind of a flash of Hitler's shadow. And I do think it's because of our actions, the way the Dulles brothers disavowed the orders and did this. I didn't realize it was such a massive amount of cooperation, and then went on to create the shadow government. So for me now, I kind of see it as some coherence, and I do think it's important to stand up and shine a light on it, or to know that this is our history.
Yeah. Brilliant. Yeah. I mean, that was the beginning of the CIA. Dallas, 1947, that's how it got started.
Let
me say, there's a book called Brothers I've heard about. It's on the reading list, about Alan and John Foster Dulles.
Yes.
One of them became Secretary of State and set up these policies, like to assassinate Dulles and things like that. While the other one ran the CIA and did the dirty work, while the other one did the public relations. And then it kind of culminates too in how Kennedy, after the Bay of Pigs, wanted to break up the CIA.
Yes.
And Alan Dulles was fired, and he didn't appear again in public until the warrant
trial.
Told the people what they could say at the warrant commission.
And I think that book is written by the same author as The Devil's Chessboard, the book I read. I think.
Could be. Yeah, it sounds like the same, very similar.
Yeah.
Anybody else who hasn't spoken yet?
Yeah.
What's the name of that book again?
The Devil's Chessboard and Brothers. His name is David Talbot. He's a local author.
We'll see.
I just found actually on an inside journal Aikido training.
Okay.
What's a poem called The Art of Peace?
Okay.
Which
yes.
Not just train in, so we are beginners. But one of the things is when something pushes on you, some attack or something challenges you, it's not to push back.
Yes.
It's center yourself and work with it.
The energy.
Like one of the big lessons I learned from Carlson say was that he said, never grab.
Oh,
then it's all over, the energy
okay.
gets stuck, it's not flowing
okay.
anymore,
okay.
it's all over. So you have to never grab and pull someone, you want this to happen, work with it, center yourself, and it needs to be healing for everyone.
Right.
So work from the heart and
Absolutely. Maybe let's end with that very positive note. We've got about 2 or 3 minutes to lunch. Thanks a million, guys, for the extraordinary sharing today. So tomorrow, God willing, we're going to focus completely on the light and how we develop the light in ourselves. But having used the light to identify the obstacles, we now look to how do we remove the obstacles by developing even greater light and becoming enlightened beings. So that will be the focus for tomorrow. Yes,
thank you.